And without any further ado, really, it's with great pleasure that I welcome the Minister of Conservation, the Honourable Eugenie Sage, to the stage to kick this off.
Emihiana kitarangi, emihiana kitafenua, emihiana kinamaunga, emihiana kinawai koriparipo, emihiana kitahunga mate, emihiana kiatato tahunga ora, tena tato katoa. And can I particularly acknowledge Pita, Kaumatua Pita, Kuia June for their mihi whakatau, and also acknowledge Ngati Kuri, Te Ati Awa, as mana whenua, and Motiti Hapu, who are here today as well. When I speak, I do like to acknowledge te kaio, because nature is at the heart of our success as a country, as a people. It's at the heart of our success for our tourism industry. It's at the heart of who we are. For Māori, the natural environment is a key part of culture, of identity, and it is also for all of us as New Zealanders. Our personal experiences, our connection with nature, contribute so much to our well-being, to our health. So that is why you have three ministers coming to Forest and Bird today, because we recognise the importance of nature for our country of Aotearoa. It's our natural landscapes, our taonga species, our kiwi, our kaka, our kia, our cabbage trees. They are what draw visitors here, and they are what make us who we are, particularly because so many of these species are endemic to New Zealand. They are only found here and nowhere else in the world. The ecosystem services that the natural environment provides for our primary industries are absolutely fundamental. The clean water, the soil for growing crops, the wetlands that filter nutrients, as well as providing habitat for so many species. So when nature thrives, we as a people thrive. We benefit in so many ways from the contribution which biodiversity and ecosystem services make to our cultural well-being, our social well-being, our lifestyle and our livelihoods. And yet, here in Aotearoa, our species extinction rates are among the highest in the world, as Forest and Bird members well know. Around 4,000 of our native plants and wildlife are threatened or at risk of extinction. In the 750 years since people arrived in these islands, more than 50 of our bird species have become extinct. Three frogs, at least three lizards, one freshwater fish, four plants, and an unknown number of invertebrates. And just this month, kauri, which Ngati Kuri and others in the north so revere and such an important majestic tree, threatened with kauri dieback and classified for the first time as one of our threatened plant species because of that kauri dieback. The major other threats to our biodiversity, as Frost the Bird knows, are predators, possums, rats, stoats, cats, and of course our use of nature and habitat loss. But as a country, we have achieved significant success where we've been able to invest in recovery efforts. 22 bird species, including rauiwi, takahe, and mahua, have improved their threat status since 2012. The rauiwi population has more than doubled since Operation Nest Egg started in 1994. But there are too many species which are continuing to decline or only just hanging on. We are in the midst of a biodiversity crisis. And as Minister of Conservation, it is my priority to do all that I can to work towards turning that crisis around alongside iwi, alongside hapu, and alongside organisations like Forest and Bird, which has played such a central role for decades, and alongside councils and communities. So one of my priorities, and we're looking now with Te Papa Arawhai, the Department of Conservation, to how do we go about reviewing the Biodiversity Strategy 2000. It expires in 2020, but it has been a document which I think has started the collaborative effort between councils, between government agencies, between iwi and hapu and communities in tackling biodiversity. But my first priority as minister was actually the pūtea, the money. Getting more funding for a Department of Conservation which has been under-resourced for the last 20 years. You all know, because Forest and Bird has stood so long beside the Department of Conservation, Te Papa Arawhai. It was Sue Maturin who organised the Love Doc campaign, which highlighted the budget cuts, the loss of more than 200 staff in those successive restructurings. So for me, during the last, or the first of the 6 months of this government's term, we were running campaign budget in our office, focusing on how to convince Treasury that Te Papa Arawhai needed more resources. And pleased to say that budget 2018 delivered that. Budget 2018 provides $181 million in additional funding over the next 4 years for the department. It's the biggest increase in operational funding for Te Papa Arawhai since 2002. And it delivers on the promise of all three parties in government, Labor, the Greens, and New Zealand First, to significantly increase conservation funding. It gives DOC the resources to ramp up predator control, to improve habitat protection, to reduce the extinction risk to our threatened species, and to protect and restore biodiversity on land, in freshwater, and in the marine space. It's not all that we asked for. In fact, it's quite significantly less than we asked for. And one budget doesn't solve the underfunding issue, but it is a very good start. And I think it recognises that this government is backing nature. So all credit to Forest and Bird for the work that it has done in publicising the impacts of the underfunding. This graph shows, and the dotted line is how DOC's funding would have continued if the former government had still been in power. The solid green line is the result of budget 2018 and that $181 million in extra funding over 4 years, which will be baselined after that. So it's a 16% increase on the current conservation budget. So how's it going to be used? Well, conservation's a big winner in the budget. Rats, stoats and possums are the big losers, because $81.2 million over 4 years is being dedicated to tackling the predator crisis. Because you'll know that in mast years, where you get these predator plagues, the eruptions of rats and then of stoats after the big seed drop from the beech trees, the rimu trees, the podocarps, and then once those seeds have either germinated or rotted away, you get the rats and the stoats turning their attention to the birds. Those predator plague years are just awful for our native wildlife. So what DOC is now doing with this extra $81 million for predator control, it means it won't have to go cap in hand to government in those mast years. And we are expecting a serious mast year next year. What it also means is with that secure funding, it can work with the helicopter companies to do the landscape aerial control so that they can plan ahead. It will mean more efficient operations. The funding will be targeted to priority ecosystems, the 100 or 1,000 key sites that DOC has identified as the best remaining examples of New Zealand's 100 unique priority ecosystems. And it will enable that multi-year control so that by 2020-21, DOC will be doing sustained predator control, both trapping and aerial control using 1080 on 1.85 million hectares. That's about 25% of the conservation estate. It's not enough, but it is a good start. It's a great start. And I'd like to pay tribute to the Finance Minister, Grant Robertson, living in Wellington, where people are now complaining about kaka waking them up. He knows about the halo effect that Zealandia has had, what happens when you get rid of predators, and how nature thrives. And similarly, the Prime Minister, the Right Honourable Jacinda Ardern, their support was absolutely critical to getting this funding increase. So, One of the reasons that I focus on getting more funding for the department, and particularly for predator control, is the difference that it makes between failure and success. The graph there is what failure looks like. It's in the Takaputahi area in the Rakakumara region of the East Coast, where there's been monitoring of wheo since the early 1990s. And the wheo population there continued to decline despite increased trapping efforts. But because of limited funding, DOC was unable to expand its pest management. The higher priority areas in the region were receiving funding, but it was a case of too little, too late. So you'll see on the left-hand side of the graph, that was back in about 1992. Then in 2016, when DOC surveyed the area, there were no wheo found. So what happened when you do get that sustained predator control is the graph on the right, where there was a significant increase in the number of adult wheo, so that now in 2017, there are over 600 birds with 378 ducklings fledging successfully. So that has been the result of ongoing and sustained control at secure sites with the assistance of Genesis and its commitment to the wheo partnership. But those sites in Whirinaki, Tauruera, Tongariro, Manganui Atiao, that shows what happens when you get that sustained control. So the number of pairs that exist there has been more than doubled since 2011. Another story of success is in South Westland, in the Landsborough Valley. Now that runs 50 kilometres parallel with the Haast Highway from the Southern Alps before joining the Haast River. And this is probably the longest area of continuous monitoring that the department has done in terms of forest birds. So about 20 years ago, DOC noticed that forest birds were declining because of the predation pressure from rats, stoats and possums. And since 1998, Aerial 1080 has been used six times, and each spring for those last two decades, researchers have gone into the valley and counted the birds. So it's the most consistent data set, and what it shows, monitoring bird call, is that mohua, kaka, tui, korimako, the brown creeper, rifleman, grey warbler, kakariki, fantail, tomtit, kereru, silver eye and long-tailed cuckoo have all increased in numbers. Only the silver eye and actually the long-tailed cuckoo numbers have declined. Kaka and fantail numbers went up and down, but then sort of have generally stayed stable. So mohua particularly, the bush canary, their numbers have steadily increased since pest control began. Back in 1998, there were only 14 mohua. By 2017, as a result of that sustained control, the six operations, over 338 birds. So that is a tribute to aerial control, and I had the opportunity of going into the Landsborough several years ago during spring, and the cacophony of birds was extraordinary. So that's what we can achieve with this additional funding doing landscape scale control. So I'm really pleased to announce today that as part of that additional $81 million for predator control, the Department of Conservation will be allocating $2 million over the next couple of years to doing the planning and the feasibility for a massively ambitious operation to do predator control to eradicate cats, mice and pigs from Auckland Island in the sub-Antarctics. Project. The island is 46,000 hectares in size. Was lucky enough earlier this year to go down to Antipodes Island, where the Department of Conservation, working with WWF, Island Conservation and the Morgan Foundation with the $1 million mouse program, has successfully eradicated mice. That operation was extraordinary. It required about 5 years in the planning, because it's not just a matter of sending the helicopters up, they had to ship three helicopters down there on a freighter, take off all the rotor blades, then when they got there, assemble them on the ship, set up, because on land there are only two small huts, set up a whole operation and sort of facility there to keep all the bait dry, then run this operation in quite difficult, challenging weather during the winter. So Auckland Island's here, is a whole different ball game. It's building, obviously, on DOC's success in island eradications elsewhere, Campbell Island and the like, Antipodes, but it is a whole different ball game getting to 46,000 hectares. But this is why we need to do it. If you look closely at that slide, you'll see some black shapes. Those are pigs. They are rooting amongst the white-capped mollymorphs. So their rooting, of course, has a major impact on the plants. They're competing with other species, with the mice and the cats. They are incredibly predatory. Major impact on the invertebrates. So it's not just a case of going down there and shooting them. If we're going to get rid of them, there's a huge amount of planning and very sophisticated technical work that has to be done looking at the feasibility. So that's what that $2 million will go towards, doing the planning so that we get an operation that's as successful as the Antipodes. Other initiatives with Predator Free is obviously the Taranaki Maunga project, $11.7 million from Predator Free New Zealand Limited, the company, charitable company which the former national government set up, which is focused on predator control, predator technology, and that is working in association with the work that's being, the regional council's doing work around the Maunga on the ring plain to actually restore the national park and the forest around it to health, with strong involvement by the eight Taranaki iwi. And this is an area that's absolutely critical for me as Minister, developing a much stronger and more effective relationship with our treaty partners. So DOC is developing and implementing best practice engagement that will embed systematic, predictable engagement processes between Te Papa Arawhai and our treaty partners, iwi and hapu, at local, regional and national levels. Supporting iwi and hapu with capacity and capability building, hoping to establish a more sophisticated training scheme in the North Island, and supporting the delivery of enduring treaty settlements. Was in Taniatua recently with Tūhoe in terms of what they have done with Te Uruwera. Their Te Kawa or Te Uruwera, their management plan is probably the most value-centric management document that I have read. The values that must be protected in terms of the management of Te Uruwera. If you haven't read it, I'd encourage you to do so. The Mackenzie Basin was down there yesterday, had some really good meetings with the Mackenzie Community Trust, the Mackenzie District Council. It is an area that Forest and Bird again has led in highlighting the impacts of intensification, the huge loss of ecological values, impacts on landscape values that I'm sure Di Lucas will be talking about later today, the international significance of these dryland habitats in the Mackenzie Basin, the connection between the big braided rivers, the big outwash plains, the glacially shaped landscapes, and how on that basin floor we've seen a conversion to a landscape reminiscent of the Canterbury Plains. The budget provides an extra $2.6 million to work towards better biodiversity protection, including our Mackenzie Drylands Park and Heritage Area. Community effort. Khaki, the black stilt, this is a young one, that's why it's not completely black. There's been enormous success with that breeding program. Khaki would have gone extinct if it hadn't been for the Wildlife Service and then the Department of Conservation getting involved in breeding and release. And so there are really good things happening there, but the environment that khaki are being released into needs to be better protected. The balance of the budget is $16.2 million going into strengthening DOC's organisational capacity and capability. The department lost over 200 staff in the restructurings over the last decade. That had a major impact in terms of the loss of institutional knowledge. There's funding in there too for just improving staff housing in some of the remote areas. It's quite often difficult to get staff in areas like Franz Josef, even in Twizel, because the tourism and visitor pressures put an enormous pressure on available accommodation. So it's going to address the backlog in maintenance there and improving human resources support for the department as well. But what is also critical is some more policy capability. To actually rebuild DOC's RMA advocacy function, And that was again one of my priorities as Minister, making it very clear to Te Papa Arawhai it has a statutory responsibility to advocate for nature. It's in the Conservation Act, and for too long, over the last decade, it has been left to Forest and Bird, to Fish and Game, to the Mackenzie Guardians and community organisations to do all that mahi of standing up for nature in front of local councils. So DOC is developing a strategy now to work alongside Kiwi, Kapu and community organisations to highlight what are the significant areas that it should be engaged in making presentations to councils under the RMA and under the EZ legislation to provide that ecological and biodiversity information that often may not be at the council. Won't be doing everything. I know Forest and Bird often thinks that it should be everywhere, but the department is working to be more strategic and to put more effort into that area. But it's also because this government is committed to measuring success differently, not just using GDP as an indicator of our economic success, but using the well-beings, natural capital, social capital, cultural capital, human capital. So measuring well-being is about measuring how we're doing in the nature space, how well our biodiversity is doing. So DOC needs to be more involved in influencing policy here in Wellington, around fresh water, around climate change, and around tourism. Because in the past, tourism growth has, in numbers has been promoted, but we haven't had a strategy, we haven't had a plan. So in that area, there was a big commitment of $70 million under the last national government to assist the department in planning for visitors with facilities. But the funding and budget 2018, the $5.5 million, is going much more into planning, spatial planning. If visitors are coming to places like Aorangi Mount Cook, is it just that they're going to the national park? How do we provide the facilities so that they are staying in places like Twisel, leaving their cars outside the park, looking at other transport options so that we're not just building more car parks, more facilities to respond to the increased visitor pressure. Fresh water, going quite fast because I realise we're running late. Again, Minister Parker will be speaking later about the work he is leading to tackle the water crisis that we have in Aotearoa. But in the conservation space, it's doing better by our native freshwater fish. Changing the Conservation Act to provide better, more effective regulations to protect all of our freshwater species, not just the grayling, which is the only species they currently protect, and it's extinct. So there are around 39 native freshwater species that DOC assess. 72% of those are threatened with extinction. We've got to do better in protecting their habitats, like wetlands, preventing further decline, installing fish barriers for trout, which Fish and Game does accept in some key catchments. In the marine space, and again, Minister Nash will be talking to you more about this, the Kermadec Rangitahua, the failure to consult iwi appropriately before that was announced has led to a tangle there. Minister Parker is leading the work in resolving that with Minister Davis as Minister of Crown Māori Relations. But we are, both Minister Nash and myself, expecting recommendations from Ministry of Primary Industries or Fisheries New Zealand now and Department of Conservation on the Southeast Marine Protection Forum, its recommendations. And Sue Maturin obviously played a critical role representing nature conservation in that space. There wasn't a wholehearted agreement between everyone on the forum about the recommendations, so ministers have got two options, and the departments are reporting back on just how on that Southeast Otago coast we advance protection. Another priority is obviously in terms of Maui dolphin and Hector's dolphin. There is a new threat management plan being prepared with Fisheries New Zealand and Te Papa Arawhai working on that. Strong involvement by Forest and Bird, WWF and other NGOs, so that's due later this year. And I've also asked the department to look at the code of the code of practice for acoustic disturbance from seismic surveys, because there's a recognition, it's a voluntary code, it doesn't adequately provide a formal regulatory regime to protect marine mammals from the effects of seismic surveys particularly in the Territorial Sea. But with the government announcement to no new block offers, in future we should see a major reduction in seismic surveys, but those current permit holders are still entitled to apply. So just winding up so that there is time for questions. This is the land sprout, and I hope if the tech works, there's a short video here that will just show the impacts of that ongoing pest control by the Department of Conservation using aerial 1080 in the Landsborough. To sound like, and thank Forest Convert for its ongoing commitment to making sure that government listens out for the sounds of the birds, the sounds of fish in the marine environment, and making sure that we have healthy nature, because that is at the heart of who we are and it's at the heart of our success as a country in Aotearoa. Nō reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa.
We have 5 minutes for questions. Who's first? Yes,
sir. When can we expect the Papa Butterfly to start or restart intensive culling of deer, chamois, tar, goats and pigs?
3,000 tar were shot out of the Twizel office this week, because one of the things that really troubled me in preparing the budget bid was to discover that the tar population is now 35,000 animals, which is over three times what the tar management plan provides for. So have said to the department, we need to work to get that down. Have met with New Zealand Deer Stalkers, and there was a commitment, I think, by the Deer Stalking Fraternity, recognising that this is way in excess of the plan to actually assist with doing some managed hunts. So tar is a priority, because those animals do enormous damage in the central southern Alps to all of those endemic alpine buttercups, the tussocks, and yeah. So having seen photos just this week of large numbers of tar, that is a priority. In terms of deer, focusing on tar first, recognise that in some areas deer are a problem, yes, but action is underway on tar.
I'm impelled to speak to you about a specific point. I represent the grandmothers of Waitaha. Recently, your department notified us of the Waitaha River on the west coast of the South Island, allowing WestPower to increase their submission, involving us from having to comment for something that's already closed. The submissions, I mean, were closed last November. Please don't let me take up everybody's turn and questions. I'd really like you to review that. I think the dock is erring on the side of commercialism for that particular river, and I invite you to look at it. Tēnā rā koe.
Minister, thank you very much for your address, your breath of fresh air, particularly given my history, the comments about DOC resuming its advocacy function within government, that is so crucial. You also mentioned that the biodiversity strategy ends in 2 years' time. Could you give us some thoughts on what you'd like to see following that?
Thanks, Ren. There was a fruit and species strategy that the former government developed that was subject, I think, to some quite extensive comment. So I'm wondering about folding in the fruit and species strategy to the biodiversity strategy. And when the biodiversity strategy was prepared in 2000, because it was done across government agencies and with the involvement of local councils, I think that helped kick off what we're seeing now in Taranaki with the regional council committing to spending about $40 million over the next 5 years on investing in predator control around the Maunga, around the National Park. And so the review of the biodiversity strategy would have to ensure that we involve all government agencies and also local councils, and obviously it's designed in a bicultural way. So how that process will work is yet to be sorted, but there is a commitment to review and refreshing. It's still thinking, and you may obviously have some ideas on how it could be distributed, so I would welcome those.
We've got time for one more question, Karen Field.
Go ahead,
Karen.
Hi. I just want to say thanks for everything you've done so far. It's such a pleasure to see you on the news. I'm just wondering, is there any time frame for addressing the 1971 Marine Reserves Act, which was not put in the
Marine ministers, myself, Minister Parker and Minister Nash, meet regularly to discuss marine issues. The priority has been Rangitahua, the Kumarex, and actually resolving that because of the significance of that ocean sanctuary proposal. Looking at. So there's no time frame at the moment, but it is an issue that we're very mindful of. Thank you.
I think you'll agree with me that it is a massive pleasure and privilege to have a Minister for Conservation who is a Minister for Conservation and who understands both the breadth and depth of the issues that our natural world is facing, and who is determined, like us, to actually do something about those. So there was so much in that speech that I really appreciated. But if I could just highlight one thing that I thought was extra special, that commitment to eradicate pests from Auckland Island and the Southlands. Fantastic. I was there last year, had the privilege of visiting Auckland Island and Campbell Island, which has already had the eradication operation, and the difference is really striking. Campbell Island is this fantastic paradise of southern seabirds, and Auckland Island is a pale imitation of the place right now. So very much looking forward to that amazing initiative. Thank you very much, Minister. So please join me once again in thanking the Minister.